Hello and welcome, and thank you for joining us online. Today, as we continue our stewardship series, we look at God's ownership. As believers, we understand that God owns everything. He owns all the vineyards, and we are just his assigned tenants to work his fields. That we are there to help produce, to bring a profit, to use what God has gifted you and I with to help bring forth the better good for the kingdom of God. But the problem is that we're in the midst of a struggle, a battle for ownership. And all those who have walked with Jesus then, and there's a struggle for ownership still now, of us fighting for what we feel like is ours. We long for the right and the idea of ownership. But in the idea of ownership, it's the creating of guidelines. It's a structure. It's a path. It's a process for us. It's a buffer of obedience for us to walk. We're like a child bowling, and God is our guardrails. Here we are going to bounce side to side, back and forth, but no doubt about it, God is continuing to use us. He's able to guide us along the right path, but the process requires trust, requires faith. For you and I to believe in this, but not only just to have a belief, but I say, I want to live this. It's the power of being a tenant. But here's the thing that we need to understand. We are not responsible for the outcome. God is. We are responsible to be obedient. See, we're a lost generation seeking to find our will and to find our purpose. It's one of the most common questions we seek today. When you feel like you're starting over, whenever you feel like life has hit a stopping point, what is my purpose? I begin to question, we begin to wonder, we begin to seek, and so many have tried to find that in different places. Rather than going to the source, we long for purpose and we long to be meaningful. But even more so, we long to be happy. There's a world out there who's hurting, who are using different elements and substances to create a happiness. Happiness is something we all long for, but we realize that happiness is just an emotion. Joy is everlasting. And in this, we realize that when we are God's ownership, when he owns, when we're part of this family, we're part of this connection, we're able to give freely and live freely and to understand that that's where the joy comes from. See, the will of God will lead us. Because so often we think, well, that door closed on me. But maybe you realize that the will of God never will lead you to where the grace of God cannot keep you. Everything works and is leading through trust. So for us, we're finding God's will for our life is discovering by trusting in his word, trusting in the Son, that we would live and follow and walk obediently. So we're looking for this pure and lasting joy. We want to be fulfilled, but at the same time, fulfillment is only found on the other side of obedience. I don't know about you, but our kids love snacks. Anybody else? Their request starts like this: Dad, I'm starving. I'm so hungry. Can we get a snack? You know what I'm talking about, when they lay it on really thick. As if we didn't just feed them a full meal just an hour ago. So you cave and you say, sure, you can get something to fill you up. Dad, can I have this chocolate bar? If you need chocolate, you're not starving. And as I say that, I'm sure some of you are acting like I just cursed, like, what, chocolate's not a meal? Of course chocolate is a meal, and you need it. But for too many people, they're spiritually living and trusting God with the little things, with little fulfillment. We say a little obedience is better than none, and a little trust is better than none. But it's not what we're called to. But at the same time, because we sit back and we think my life doesn't feel full, I'm doing these things in part, but not feeling fulfilled. God is waiting for us to be all in, to take something of substance. So how do we develop a life that is revolving around faith and trust? A willingness response to the things that we know and we've learned and that we're willing to live out. See, Psalms 139, 23, and 24 says, "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me, know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting." Submission is giving God full ability and control here. When we think about those passages, we can see a few things that God is doing here. First is that God, it says, "I know you." He knows everything about us. He makes us happy, what brings joy. He also understands what makes us uneasy, anxious, and stressed. So the thing here is that nothing surprises God, because he knows what's in our heart and on our minds. He warns us to stay away from those things that stir those emotions and feelings up inside of us, the things that have damaging effects upon us. And so the psalmist is giving an invitation to God to search us and see what is truly there. That's powerful. That's a powerful invitation. It's not just, "Hey, why don't you stop by, come and go." He says, "I want you to be part of this." Think about this, what we see here that they're offering to God. It's like having someone come over, and not only you say, "Hey, make yourself at home, hey, put your feet up on the, you know, on the stool there, wherever, you know, sit back, relax," but it's more so, "Hey, I want you to come over and feel free to look through anywhere in the house that you want. Look through everything. It's great." You might be thinking, "Well, I don't really have anything to hide," but at the same time, you really don't want them going through your dark closet either. The stuff that you've just thrown in there. And so the psalmist is telling God, "I'm inviting you to search all of me." Now, that is surrender. That is your willingness to say, "God, here I am." That is submission. Welcome in. King David says in 1 Chronicles 28, he says, "And you, my son Solomon, acknowledge the God of your father and serve him with the wholehearted devotion and with a willing mind, for the Lord searches every heart and understands every desire and every thought. If you seek him, he will be found by you. But if you forsake him, he will reject you forever." See, we need to realize that in this midst of searching, God is our guide. God is longing to lead us. And so the psalmist is calling out to God to search him. Not only invitation to say, "Hey, here I am, all of me, take a look around," but he says, "Search me," because he understands and he believes that God knows where his weaknesses, he knows his strengths, and so he's going to lead them to avoid those damaging effects of our weaknesses, to lead life, and to understand what his heart needs to be successful. Because he knows what can capture our heart. He can understand what can lead us astray, the worry, the anxiety. And so this is significant. Whenever we pray, cry out, "Lead me in the way of everlasting," maybe we should better pray it like this: "Lord, lead me where I need to go, because I get lost easily. I get distracted." But even more so, what the psalmist is opening up there with, he says, "God, I'm giving it back to you. That you've given this to me, that you've blessed me in my life, but I want my life to be yours, that I can trust you. What does God want for my life?" It's a call to look inward about who we are. See, Proverbs chapter 3 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean on not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. This will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with your first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflow and your vats with the brim over the new wine." See, this right here, we begin to see a few requirements it requires. If we trust, if we submit, if we're willing to be humble, if we respect the wisdom and knowledge, if we're willing to honor God with our wealth, if we do these things, God will strengthen our path. He refreshes our existence to bless our efforts. And for us, he says, that's when you experience the overflow of the blessing. When we turn ourselves completely over to the Lord, we begin to fully see what he has in store for us. But it takes, as God is our source, it goes back to the beginning steps of building trust. In saying, "God, I understand, I don't know, I'm worried, but I trust that you will be sufficient enough for me." That we realize that he is our salvation, that he is our life, he is our stronghold, So if we have that, if God is on our side, then who shall we fear? See, without God, we can do nothing or understand anything or become anything that lasts. So as we live each day, day to day, by what feels good, if we feel like our own strength, our own ability, by our own supply, may we never forget to realize the source of that strength, the source of that ability, the source of that supply. All of that is done by the work of God that He's begun in us already. He's the owner. We're the tenants of the vineyards. In His trees, we seek to grow. Hebrews 5, chapter, verse 7 says, during the days of Jesus' life on earth, He offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save Him from death. And He has heard because of His reverent submission. Son, though He was, He learned obedience from what He suffered. And once made perfect, He became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey Him. John Maxwell writes, three reasons people don't give more of their time, their talent, or treasure is because some begin to question. They question God's faithfulness. Whether God will take care of us as the church. Some won't trust because they don't know what's expected, uncertain why we give. And some won't trust because they make no provisions to give. We lack the faith to give God opportunity to show us. But it requires surrender. It's not all that we have. As we looked last week, we saw those who did much with little. And so that doesn't determine the level of our generosity. It doesn't determine the greatness of our wealth because I didn't have as much to give, but it's, were you willing to give all that you had? Are you graciously now or graciously then? When we think about the story in Jeremiah, the self-reliant man, we see in chapter 17, thus says the Lord, curses the man who trusts in the mankind and makes flesh his strength, and whose heart turns away from the Lord. For he will be like a bush in the desert, and will not see when prosperity comes, but will live in the stony wasteland, in the wilderness, the land of salt without inhabitants. But then we also see the God-reliant man. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, and whose trust is the Lord, for he will be like a tree planted by the water that extends its roots by a stream and will not fear when heat comes. But its leaves will be green and will not be anxious in a year nor drought nor cease to yield fruit. Are we going to live by the strength? Are we going to live by a strength that is unreliable, that's not lasting, that's not sufficient, that will not bring greatness and will not sustain forever? The question that we have here is, who do we put our trust in? Because if we look at our calendars, we look at our checks, we can see where our investment is. We can see where our faith is. So where do we put our trust? And whom do I put my trust in? That we would tithe in part of promise. Tithe the tenth part of one's yearly income produced set aside for sacred purposes. Biblical reasons, as we think about this, why every Christian should tithe their time, treasure, and talents. We see tithing on the promises, the historical response to God's ownership. All the way back in the beginning of Genesis chapter 14, verse 20. And blessed be God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand. Then Abram gave him a tenth of everything. We see here that Abraham offered God a tithe before the law was given to Moses at Sinai, which negates the argument that tithing is Old Testament law and not expected today. We see in Malachi chapter 3, will a man rob God, yet he robbed me? But you ask, how do you rob you? In tithes and offerings, you are under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. It begins to talk about, this is the requirement. Everyone has required tithe in everything they have. Every Jew was required by the Levitical law to pay three tithes of his property. One tithe for the Levites, one for the use of the temple and the great feasts, and one for the poor of the land. But then we see in Matthew chapter 23, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You give a tenth of your spices, but you have neglected that more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter without neglecting the former." Jesus was teaching them that the tithe encompasses more than just duty. It's a demonstration of response to God's work in our lives and in our communities. So we tithe on a promise, but yet the attitude must be in gratitude. As we see in Psalms 116, "How can I repay the Lord for all the goodness to me? I will lift up my cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of his people." See, tithing is a natural response of the church. We have received God's Son, his salvation, his presence, his blessing, and we will receive his inheritance someday. We are the means by which this and the future generations will know and receive those same gifts. So how can we think of giving him less than the tithe? How can we not live to provide shade to his glory? We're tithing on a promise. It requires our faith. God has promised blessing to those who are faithful, to those who practice stewardship of giving. Malachi 3:10 simply puts it this way: "Trust me in this." Faith is God's promise. It's reflected by our trust in his word and building the foundation that Christ has already begun in us. To know his will for our lives and find the lasting fulfillment. We see those who have passed the test of God's promise. Everyone who's passed the test in this life has passed the test of trust. Noah trusted in God and is not in his knowledge. Abraham trusted God, not in his feelings. Joshua trusted in God, not in his methods. And David trusted God, not in his weapons. The difference that we make in this world will not be by our own power, by our own influence, by our own significance and nature, but by the Holy Spirit's power. And it will come to those who trust the owner and trust be to his servants. To those who are true servants. This is not easy to talk about. It's not an easy reaction. But to be honest, trusting God as owner is much more difficult. Talking about ownership issues are easy. Trusting God as owner is more difficult. So how will we respond? How will we take part in this? Will we respond in submission? Will I rely on God as the most sufficient source, the source of all? Will I study and understand God's clear principles of ownership? Will I surrender all things to his leading, to his direction? Will I tithe my life to his work? Will I be part of his vineyard? Will I plant myself there so for future generations, the kingdom of God will still be present and effective? Are we willing to have trust in the life and the ministry of the King? Will we build our life on his foundation? Will we partner into what he has already begun doing? Yes, I will.